So, Jude, one really important question is, where do you get your influence from?
I think growing up in Brighton, which I did in the kind of 60s and 70s, was such a important time for music that so much of the kind of influence I have underneath my skin is revolves around music and youth culture. And I suppose when I reached an age where I was going to gigs, maybe 14, 15, going to punk gigs, and that is kind of in my DNA, it's in my blood, and then I wanted to be part of every youth culture movement from then on. And I was lucky that I did grow up in an era where we went from punk to, ska, to two-tone, to goth, to hip-hop, to new romantic. There was just such a massive scene of youth culture, which was hair was so influential. When you look at all those youth cultures, even if you look at skinheads and you look at hippies, you've got the extreme opposite. But the hair, the fact there's no hair is saying something, and the fact that there's really long hair, which hasn't been cut for years, is saying something. There's a form of rebellion in both of those. And when you look at, say, punk and new romantic and goth, the hair, especially even for the boys, is just as much, it's a massive part of the look. And when I was deciding where I really needed to kind of pinpoint my aesthetic, I just went back to my youth and just went back through all the old music I had, rethought about all those clubs that I went to in Brighton and all those gigs I went to and all the clubs that I started going to in London and in the 90s, going to raves and going to clubs like gay clubs like Heaven and places like that, where there was a kind of a almost like a 20-year period of time when you crossed over so many amazing youth cultures, which was so almost had a everything was kind of rebellious, everything was saying something. And I thought that's what my work needs to do. My work needs to say something. Like all of those youth cultures, which I know something about. I've lived through them. I've done the hair for them. I just need to adjust adjust it into high fashion, which for me was, I didn't find that difficult. I found it easy to pick up on those references. I mean, the main thing is that it was changing the references and not making them too literal. And just taking certain elements of them and adding them into a fashion idea. I think, I do feel very lucky and privileged that I lived through such an incredible time in history with so much great youth culture and so much great music and political problems as well. And youth culture tends to represent what's going on politically, growing up in in the 70s. And into the early 80s, when things weren't good in Britain, that's when punk came about. That's when all the rebellion started. It was a reaction and a response to what was happening politically. And if you go through all of time looking at reaction with youth culture, there's always something going on politically, which is, it kind of gives a kind of an excuse and a layer to go into some sort of a reaction from the youth. Which I'm not sure happens so much today visually, generally. I mean, I make myself sound old saying it's different now, but, and there is still really good scenes and, great scenes in big cities going on underground scenes, subculture. But, we were, punks at school, and it was a lot more general. You could see it, it was a real response and reaction. So I think, a lot of my influences come from that. And then I've had to kind of tame those into a high fashion sensibility. But when you go across all of youth culture from America, New York to London, where there was really good subcultures, fashion is always referenced back to that. And I think it's so important as a young hairdresser to is understand your references. When people says, I want a suede head,
What is a suede head?
what's a suede head? It's good to understand the subtleties between the difference of a rude boy, a skinhead, and a suede head. The hair length varied by a centimetre. Yeah. Or the hairline on a suede head was just softer. You know, it wasn't really harsh like it was on a skinhead. And then a kind of rude boy head was kind of in between the two. You know, and it's just all those little subtleties of those youth cultures stood me in really good stead, because a lot of people knew that I understood what the reference was. So that's what I ended up drawing back on for me. And I do consider myself lucky that I had those experiences and lived through that time.
So how do you take these your experiences through these subcultures and influences into ideas and for hair and shoes?
I think for me personally, I'd say, you know, I think we all know what we're good at and what we're not so good at. And, you know, in all honesty, I don't think I'm particularly technically, you know, I'm not technically I don't know if I'm the best hairdresser from a real technical point of view, but I find my way through from an idea. So for me as a hairdresser, it's very important that I have a strong idea and that those ideas are manifesting themselves in my head so that I can then turn it into a technique. I think technique is so important, whether you're cutting hair, whether you're demonstrating session stuff like you do with SENZI, or you're educating with very technical haircuts. It's really, really important to have a base of technique. But I do feel that, and I feel now that a lot of people get tied up very much in technique. There's so much online tutorials or, you know, Instagram videos over technique, and I think they're really useful and really helpful. However, it's having the idea, you know, and being able to carry an idea across the story, and being able to, you know, if you can have all the technique in the world, but if you don't have a good idea, the technique is not worth anything, because you can't put it anywhere, you know. So I think that, as well as my advice to younger hairdressers would be, to focus very much on your idea as well as your technique. You know, your technique can come, but if you don't think about the idea enough, then you're constantly going to go back to the same thing.
Yes.
You're going to go back to your strongest technique, because it's all you got in the locker. And you know, when we're doing tests for shows and things like that, you know, you've got to come up with an idea very, very quickly. And that has to be part of your training and part of your kind of mental mindset, to be able to come up with an idea quickly when you show a designer something and they're like, yeah, it's okay, it's fine, yeah, it's all right. What else can we do to this? You've got to be able to think of something on the spot. And so for me, the idea, I can figure the rest out later, but having the idea is so important. So it's about, you know, me taking my influences and then transferring them into a relevant idea, you know, because there's no point taking a full-on literal punk look and dropping it into a fashion context where it doesn't work. Sometimes it's not about the look. It's not about a big spike or, you know, a mohawk. It's not about that literally. It's about an attitude, and it's about transferring the attitude of a punk. So it's got a feeling of it. So it's not quite full on. It's not quite there, but it's got an element of punk to it. And it's understanding how that attitude fits into a fashion context.
That's interesting.
So yeah, that's kind of really important for me. And I spend a lot of time thinking about that and focusing on how I'm going to transfer a literal reference into something which works in that context of it actually, it's saying it's punk, but it's not obvious, it's not literal. And I think that's one of the hardest things to do in this business, is transferring that into a context that works. It's modern, it looks cool, it works with the story. And it's understanding the character of the model. It's understanding the clothes. It's understanding, you know, the attitude of the clothes. You know, if it's Comme des Garçons, for example, it's understanding their ethos, their attitude. How can you add a kind of a punk element into that without it just being punk, you know, for example?
Like doing your homework beforehand, you know, just making sure who you're dealing with, who your client is, what's their aesthetic, what did they do before.
And I think also constantly exposing yourself to, it's all about exposure, and taste is we're not born with taste, you know, taste develops. It's from influences. It comes from maybe our parents or our brothers or sisters or, you know, where we first go to work, you know. Your taste develops in the first salon you ever worked for. I mean, the first salon I went to work for, they were like in a very creative bunch of people. They were on scenes, going to clubs, you know, and my taste developed very quickly from something which was Brighton and punk and, you know, Scar and all that kind of scene into a kind of completely new scene in London, which was all about kind of new romantics. It was a lot more camp, you know, I was going to heaven and, you know, gay clubs and all those kind of places. All of a sudden I had another level of taste to layer on top of the level. I didn't understand it was taste then, but that takes a long time to develop. And I think it's really important that you're constantly exposing yourself to different levels of taste by, and that's your responsibility as a young stylist, is to constantly be exposing yourself to that kind of information, whether it's going to galleries, whether it's going to bookshops, whether it's, you know, just trawling the internet, whatever it is, it's about finding out about developing your kind of base level of taste. You can't, it's very, very difficult to say, you know, teach me taste. You can't, you know, you can have all the money in the world, but it doesn't mean to say you're going to look cool.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
It's as simple as that. And that's how I feel with our job. We can have all the best training, you know, worked on the biggest teams, the biggest shows, you know, done first assistant for the best hairdresser, but you still have some responsibility to learn what taste truly is. And taste can be a bit pretentious. It's a pretentious word, and I don't like to overuse it, but I think it's essential that one understands what that actually means.
So, do you think everyone that is, you know, listening to your story is probably wondering, you know, how do you come up with the story? You know, where do you go to research your ideas that you've been building up for years and years and years? That would be, you know, I think good for everybody to.
Yeah, I mean, again, I've got to kind of make myself sound really old here, but growing up in a time where we couldn't research the internet kind of disciplined me into going out and looking for things. And, you know, a lot more research was very DIY. I mean, don't get me wrong. I use the internet a lot, and I think it's a very, very good source to find inspiration and find ideas. There's so many ways you can find great stuff on there. And I recently discovered old punk films I'd never seen before and footage, which, you know, I just didn't know existed. And I found that amazing. But I also, I'm a big fan of buying books and like zines and things like that. And I surround myself with that. I like the feeling of them being around me. Mm. I like the feeling of walking past the bookshelf and thinking, God, I haven't looked at that in a few years, and getting re-inspired. So it's not like, and thinking, God, I could do something with that. There's something there. I haven't looked at that book for years, but there's something there for what I need now. So the ideas are coming to you and the research is coming to you. You're not going to it. And I think it's also really important to keep yourself energized by going to events, going to gigs, going to, you know, club nights, going to galleries, going to bookshops. Because when you're going to a bookshop, you're not going in mind to buy anything specific. You won't think, oh, go to Broadway Market and go to a bookshop to look for an idea, for research, for a specific thing. You're just going as a pastime, and during that process you're discovering something, and you get to know somebody in the bookshop and they're like, oh, hi, Gary, how are you? Oh, look, we just had this come in. You're going to love this. Mm. So an idea is coming to you, you know, an influence has just come to you. You haven't gone to look for it. And while you're there looking for something, you find another amazing book that you didn't expect, and it sparks loads of ideas. And I can think of so many occasions when that's happened to me. And you're going to see photography exhibitions that, you know, have got nothing to do with fashion. I mean, I find those a lot more exciting and influential anyway. And while you're there, you see, oh, there's another exhibition, or there's a book by this photographer, or, you know, this kind of artist. And it's just, you know, you can go to places like the National Portrait Gallery or the National Gallery, go and look at historical art. You know, you might think, oh, there's nothing there for me. But it's amazing when you go around a gallery like the National Gallery, what there is in historical art that can be so influential. And I just think it's so important that sometimes you go to the idea, you go to the influence. You don't just sit in your home looking for something specific when you have to. It's about immersing yourself in what we discussed before, about immersing yourself and understanding taste, understanding art. I mean, art's a massive world. I don't profess to know that much about art, and I'm just learning to more about it now. And I realize how much I don't know about art and, you know, the influences that art have on what we do. So there's a, for me, you know, coming from being influenced by youth culture to trying to understand art at a very high level, whether it's historical or contemporary art, is like a whole new chapter for me. But that's definitely something I'm not going to look for on the internet. You know, it's something that I have to go and feel it. I have to go and experience it. And like we were talking, Rebecca, about some books that you got, or some pamphlets or zines you got through recently.
You know, I just looked at these. I just came up with these pictures and I clicked on it. And then, you know, once you click on something and then you keep going. It takes you in a loop and you go somewhere completely amazing. So yeah, I just saw these really interesting books.
Amazing.
They're not really books, they're sort of like little booklets.
They're very tiny,
They're like small kind of zines, aren't they? That's so beautiful, that picture.
Yeah,
incredible. And I think, you know, just having those in your possession, having those in your house, surrounding yourself with, you know, a feeling like that is so amazing. I really want those. They're so good. You know, so it's kind of, I think it's so important to, you know, not just use a screen for information, to have that stuff. So it starts to become part of you, you know, like a record collection becomes part of you.
Yeah.
You know,
when I saw these pictures in my head, I was like, oh, it's not enough for me to just see them. I need to feel it. Yeah.
And you need to, I'm sure there's, you know, stuff to read in there, which you might not be able to read on the internet.
Yeah.
And I think that that's so important, like absorbing words and text to, you know, back up ideas, to back up influences is so important. You know, there's language in there that you may not have heard before that you can pick up on.
Yeah.
And you know you're building a kind of a level of understanding of culture in general. You know, I mean, it's such an important part of what we do as session hairdressers to understand culture, whether it's youth culture or whether it's historical art or, you know, everything else in between. It's so important. So I think, I mean, they're amazing. I love surrounding myself with that stuff.
It's also good to support the artists as well. You know, it's a good way to support those, you know, artists to produce the work as well.
So, yeah, absolutely. You know. Yeah. Because so many of those photographers from those eras, you know, they're at the time they're photographing stuff that doesn't really mean much. It only means something now.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
You know?
True.
I became very passionate. I don't know if you know the photographer is called Fan Ho. He was born in Shanghai and then he moved to Hong Kong in the 50s. And at that time it was a very messy situation. And he started to create those beautiful, stunning black and white photographs of the streets of Hong Kong. The lighting, I mean, it's just beautiful. And the images were not very relevant until he was about to die. and his family decided to keep going back and collecting all his images and make it public. And I just recently bought a book from him, and it was just, it's just stunning. You know, it's just, I think having the book with you is, you know.
Books are definitely an investment.
Yeah.
I think also that it's an incredible, you're never going to lose money on good books either.
Yeah.
That's a fact. But I think if you go to a shoot, we're talking earlier in the series about communication. If you go to a shoot with a book, it gives a kind of level of confidence. Mm. Do you know? As opposed to showing somebody something on your phone.
Yeah.
It goes, you know, all of a sudden the stylist, the photographer thinks, yeah, Gary, Rebecca, they understand the idea, you know? They've researched it, they know about it, they had it, that was part of them. So it's a very, very, not only is it a great thing to have around your house, it's a great tool to have when you go to a shoot with you know, a book with post-it notes in it where you've kind of thought, these are some of the ideas that I've got, do you like this, you know?
Yeah.
So I think that's an important part of the process.
Okay guys, thanks for watching this special interview with Gary. Thanks Gary for being with us once again.
Thank you for having me. Amazing, it's been such great fun. Thanks for having me, it's been brilliant.
Thanks a lot. Bye guys, see you soon.
See you. Thank you. Bye-bye.